November 4th, council workshop. Tonight's meeting will be, and the purpose of our workshop this evening is to go over and review our goals from last year. And we're going to go ahead and give the floor right over to Tom to just kind of walk us through what the goals were and where our progress has been. And at the end, we can move back and have some discussions.
Sure. So I'm just going to pass out something I put together from my perspective, just kind of where I think we've made some advancement on many of these goals. You met in a similar session back in June and did kind of mid-year check-in. And I updated things back then in blue, and since then I've updated it in red, just so you can follow along.
Yeah.
So if it's okay, we can just kind of walk down through these very quick. Again, this is from my perspective, and I certainly encourage some discussion on the part of the council as well. The budget goal, there's a lot of subcategories there. I think, you know, technically we met many, if not all of those. Yet I don't think I'd characterize the budget process as necessarily successful, as indicated by having to go back to the voters three times. So I think there's certainly, that's an area that, warrants some further discussion by council. So I might just kind of jump right over that one and allow you to kind of dig into it. I will say going forward, staff has made some decisions to do some things differently. And I think we're going to pick up where we left off last year. I think there are a lot of good process improvements, including the joint presentation by the superintendent and myself. The budget forum, I thought, was well received and something we should replicate and improve upon. Going forward, we're looking at the school changing their presentation, their budget format, which is, I can say this from personal experience, it's not an easy undertaking, but George and Kate upstairs are receptive to the idea, and they understand that that's a critical part of going forward. So I'm very hopeful that you'll see a new format rolling out with their budget next spring.
Kind of modeled after what?
I mean, Kate Elizabeth has been suggested as a form, the school budget format that people like. I think it's up to them to find one that works for them. They may choose to look at the format we used and model it, if you will, for consistency. I really don't know yet. But
okay.
Ruth and I have offered our help in making that transition because it's not easy. There's a lot of just numbers, there's a lot of formatting and stylistic things. So I'm confident we'll make good progress there. The other thing we have committed to between town and school is creating probably a web page, but it'll be a single portal, if you will, single source of budget information.
Good.
They hosted theirs, we hosted ours. There was, you know, things were replaced, and it was very hard, admittedly, for someone who wanted to understand the budget to know where to find the relevant information, and that's certainly a fair criticism and something that is easily correctable. So we can and will roll that out next spring for sure. And beyond that, there's certainly some other process things that can and should be talked about by the council. The legislative relationships, there was an initial session with the legislative delegation back in February. I know many of you have checked in with individual legislators through the course of the session and since, but the council did not get back together with them, and that's maybe something the future council can talk about being a little more consistent in that regard.
Mm-hmm.
I think having those connections certainly can't hurt, and I would expect it does help. The townwide revile, there was a decision that we don't advance that this year, so obviously there's no progress there. That's something that future councils will inevitably talk about.
Tom, when's the comprehensive plan due?
Well, it's a general rule of every 10 years, and we're in our 10th year.
And it's just because revals have to be done on a regular basis, too, depending on how much valuation is moved in whatever way, based on it's a state. I know it's the state.
Yeah, there's certainly rules of thumb. We look very closely, as is main revenue, at your ratios.
Right.
And we consistently mark very high in the 99th percentile in terms of assessment to market ratios. There are differences. Scarborough's wide and diverse. There are vast differences in this town.
The obligation to do a reval, is it mandated, or do you have to fall out of the 90-110 range, this 10% from 100% valuation?
I think it's actually if you fall below 7%, it's a very low bar that makes it mandatory. My experience has been, and I'll verify this, I don't think it's a mandate after a certain number of years. It's really when your quality is degrading to the point that it's so far out of whack that you're manipulating the numbers and purposely staying artificially low.
Have you talked to Matt Sturgis, is it?
Yes.
Because it's always, if you keep up neighborhood by neighborhood over the years and you have a good assessor who's identifying those neighborhoods that are maybe getting out of whack because of market conditions, and I always thought that's what Paul was doing, was trying to identify where those deficiencies were and thus kept us in that narrow band.
Absolutely. And to suggest that no changes have happened since we last did an outside reval is certainly not the truth.
Right.
We do annual review of sales to assessment data, our sales data, and make changes accordingly. And as I said, Scarborough is large and diverse, from condominiums to waterfront to that farmland. And certainly all those sorts of properties don't react in the market the same way.
Because you deal with Matt all the time, it may be at some point in the months ahead that him kind of reporting to us, because we lack the education or knowledge on this whole topic.
Mm-hmm. That'd be
for us to understand where a new guy is at would really, I think, help us tell.
Yeah, your first workshop.
Absolutely. I think he'd like to actually then feel like he got to know us a little better.
Yeah. There's no question we should be looking at a reval in the relatively near future, so it'd be great groundwork to lay.
Yeah,
for sure. Economic development, largely that's set to his bailiwick.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Is it possible to comment on each one of the levels? Cause I'm debating whether to keep notes and then pile them all on at the end, or whether we can have a note topic go along. What's the preference of the council and then also the manager?
If we could let Tom kind of give the quick skim through, because obviously I'm assuming budget's probably a lot of your comp. No? Oh, well. All righty then. Sure. Go for it.
So I have to keep away from that. So Tom, you know me, I kind of look at this from an executive level. I read this and then I kind of synthesize it. And I will tell you personally, if I was to evaluate the staff's input to this, I would call it exceptional at an A to A plus rating. I think that the council input to this, though, has been what I would call an acceptable rating to a B, B minus. And the reason is that I think that the scope of how we set the, and some of it's by design, it has been a little bit too extensive and too wish-listy. There's a lot of things that covers way too much.
And I think
that we can lose some direction with that. I just want to say thank you first, before I get into some criticism. We've accomplished as I said, my evaluation of the staff is exceptional, AA+. I just want to say thank you, because it's been a very challenging year with a new board. The one piece that I wanted to recognize, and when I go through this, I kind of assess the things that we've done. There's more things that I would actually assess as being, there's been actually no change.
Right.
Or there has been a negative impact, negative being that we did absolutely nothing towards it. And so there's the great things about the budget, the responsible, realistic budget. There's been, I call the relationship with legislators really being neutral. And I have my own criticisms around that, whether or not that can actually improve or not.
I'd like to see us go to quarterly meetings.
But whether or not we're impactful, or whether or not we actually have a result from that, is what I'm concentrating on. We can have a meeting every stinking day, just like a poll with presidential candidates. Doesn't necessarily mean that we know anything more about who we're dealing with. So I just wanted to suggest, at least through the ones that we've talked about, the greatest strength that we've achieved, I think, is around economic development and understanding where SEDCO is going.
Mm-hmm.
and what they've accomplished and what their challenges are. And I really think that I hope the next council, because there's going to be some issues of continuity to the next council, I hope that we truly focus in all of these areas, synthesize them to one or two instead of eight, and suggest that we can look at that deeper, because they really tie into bigger issues, growth management ordinances, comprehensive planning. There's some big scale things that we need to really look at. So I just wanted to suggest that you've done a great job. I don't care what anybody says. Not that anybody has anything.
I don't care what your wife says.
I don't care what your wife says. No, I mean, we get a lot of criticism, and the town does too, through the process. And the things that I think that we're most that should be critical of the, is not about the staff. It's about how the council has engaged in communications, how it's engaged in its relationships with others. So, you know, we can talk about so many different things. I just think that I at least wanted to put out kind of a generic statement around all of them.
Sean, can I just
yeah.
just to address one of those concerns? Peter and I, as you know, have been working on lack of a better word, call it team building thing. And
mm-hmm.
one of the things we've talked to facilitators about is helping us with goal setting, because we are too broad, and what can we do to have them more smart? So just letting them know.
No,
that's part of the.
So I appreciate it. And I hope it ties back to, I think, if I remember my comments when we started this exercise, is that it's way too broad.
Right.
But you have to go through the exercise before you learn something.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And then you learn something at the end of it.
Yeah, I think Peter, you.
With that, I'll let you. By the way, the only other item that I personally wanted to mention, and I'll mention it later as well, is the focus and emphasis on historic preservation has probably been the most successful item that we've undertaken in many, many years
yeah.
because it supports not just the culture of the community, but also the projects that have been undertaken are also connected directly to economic development.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been huge, huge, huge. And it was specifically mentioned, by the way, at the SEDCO annual meeting in front of many, many guests. So it was wonderful to hear.
Yeah, I was just going to – I recall Peter saying this, raising this point at the time goal setting happened, and it's come up several times since. Not only should we focus on a few goals and do them well, but also establish metrics or ways to evaluate, so we actually know if we've moved the ball. And that's not an easy task. So that's another reason why to really limit the number and let's do them well. So quickly on SEDCO, if I could. Just you know, there's been a number of different initiatives here. Really, I can't say enough about Karen Martin. Many of all of you have seen her in practice, and she's really taken SEDCO to a different level, and it's an exciting time right now. She was the right person at the right time for that job, for sure. Jean Marie has sunk her teeth into some issues around high-speed internet. These are kind of large issues and hard to understand. It's not a fault or criticism of anyone that we haven't really establish some tangible things, but it's important to keep it.
Karen and I are coming up with a list right now about how we can
take
it down.
SEDCO has launched a new website. If you've not seen it, it really, and Karen and Magna to be credited, it's really
fantastic.
It's really user friendly. It will cater to the average resident and to a site locator looking for commercial real estate. Just chock full of great content. I really give her credit for that. Benchmarking, I think I made a breakthrough last month. This is a project that the town has taken on, but frankly just have dropped the ball, my staff. It keeps being pushed to the side. Budget preoccupied us for too much last year. I did approach Cumberland County. They've got a real terrific finance director, Alex Kimball. Sean has got to know him. And this would be a terrific project for Cumberland County to pick up and to run with. And the real key is someone getting on top of this thing and staying on top of it.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we've made some progress there and putting in a system that will be sustainable, frankly. And Karen is all about the numbers, so she's really interested in the demographic stuff and has committed to putting that material together on a consistent annual basis. Again, Sedco pushed this all-committee summit. They held a second annual. Many of you were in attendance. And there's a group that continues to work. And this vision committee, which is the driving force, is coming up with what they call a community engagement strategy. Some of the takeaways of the first summit and the second summit were really finding ways to plug everyone in so everyone knows what each other's doing, and better collaboration and less duplication, those sorts of things. And I think that's the central piece of that engagement strategy. Pleased to report the long-range facility plan is very close to coming to the council. I'll be asking the next council, probably in December, to have a workshop to look at the results of the staff's efforts so far. So we're very pleased to advance that this year, and it's going to, I think, tie in well with the Finance Committee's work on the capital budget policy. It's one of the pieces that will feed into that, and you quickly see how all these things start to work together. Survey of services, this is one that wasn't well defined. I wasn't quite sure what it was, and don't really have anything to report in terms of progress.
Aging in place, if I remember correctly.
Was it?
Yeah.
It was
around aging in place. That was one of my recommendations. Because the first stage of aging in place is surveying about services, so it's not something that we achieved.
The Senior Advisory Committee, and Peter is at those meetings, this group is like none other before. This group is really interested in doing some of this more forward-thinking material. And so I think you'll see some advancement, regardless of council directive. I think they're really sinking their teeth into it, and you're going to see some things coming out.
Mm.
The communication strategy is really something that I feel bad about, that we haven't been able to advance. Staff is partially responsible for slowing it down. There's a core group that really made some progress early on, and I'll take responsibility for kind of slowing it down because there's some legal issues and some policy issues that got us hung up, frankly. But it's absolutely something we need to move forward on. The world around us isn't slowing down for us, and we need to engage on every single level possible.
And I see more and more towns with Facebook presences and whatever, and I tap into them when I see them.
Yeah, I see
what they're doing.
What I've come to understand is that there's all sorts of boogeymen out there, and there's all sorts of pitfalls that we can fall into, but it's more important for us to to make efforts in this regard and kind of sort our way through it rather than find all the reasons why we shouldn't be. That's the way I can sum it up. In affordable housing and historic preservation, this is the part of the show where we start to gush praise on our outgoing council chair, but I can say this because I've worked with Jessica during her entire two terms. These are two things that she identified, I think, in her first year, and to her credit, pushed and pushed and pushed.
Yeah.
And these are two things that I think we can all be the most proud of in terms of seeing tangible results. The lesson there for us is that it takes a long time to get meaningful stuff done.
Oh, that's true.
And the other takeaway is that it requires leadership, someone to keep their foot on the gas. And that's one thing I kind of turn back to you. These are your goals. I'm certainly pleased to help you advance them. But it requires joint effort, and it requires sustained commitment. And these things, the meaningful ones, aren't easy to do and probably can't get done in a year. So that's a quick overview, and I'm certainly pleased to help you as you discuss further.
One thing that comes to mind, just kind of building with what you said, Tom, and it's going to be done different ways in different organizations. But what you just talked about is, in some organizations, when you have a goal, then you have a designated sort of owner of it, someone that kind of is responsible for shepherding it through. And we just use an example with Jessica where that worked. As we think about goal setting going forward, that may be something we want to do, that there's an owner, being a council member probably, and that owner then becomes, as you described, partially responsible for making sure it happens.
Or
so.
Kicking me in the pants, there's all sorts of distractions that take us away from these sorts of things. So someone just keeping the drumbeat alive is really important just to keep things moving.
Yep.
Good idea. That's a nice, good strategy that we can talk about.
And some of that could even be possibly committee related too. Obviously, I wish I could say, I'm not going to say, you know, it's Jessica Holbrook that was beating the war drum. There's an entire committee behind historic preservation,
yep.
and it's their work and their efforts, and me is just kind of the middle go-to person, and same thing for affordable housing. So, you know, really making sure, you know, you're championing your committees. If it's something that, you know, kind of jives with your own committee assignments going into the future, you know, really kind of keep that goal sheet. I have it floating on my desk on my court board, you know, here's our goal sheet,
mm-hmm.
And these are things we're trying to achieve, so,
okay.
And certainly, too, you know, the nice thing about goals is you know, you guys will explore, you know, better ways to continue to improve upon it. Tom was the one that kind of introduced the goals to us as a council, as a concept and an idea of let's sit down and strategize what we might like to work on for this year, and I think that was a great first step. And then we took it another step or two and said, well, let's keep it a short list because it's too long and unwieldy. So, you know, you keep kind of perfecting it. And, you know, as time goes on, you can hold your list up and say, boy, we really did a lot this year.
Yeah, just quickly, one other strategy, if you adopt this kind of someone that
co-sponsors
the goal, we can make it as part of, maybe not every meeting, but monthly, that's once you give an update. Any advancement on that goal this month? Again, just as a way to keep it fresh. Just an idea.
And I wouldn't mind seeing reporting sometimes being done in writing, because sometimes when it's just done orally, it kind of just goes whoosh.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're...
Yeah, especially at the end of a meeting.
It does. At 10 o'clock at night, I could see a little bit more formal responsibility, and I'd take it more seriously if I was asked to write up a couple sentences on what's going on, because I'd want to have it not be gibberish. I'd want to actually demonstrate some progress, which might make me work on that project in the week leading up to the meeting.
It's a strategy to keep everyone moving forward. If you know you have to report, you don't have to do it.
It's an accountability.
Yep.
You know, and I hope that, if anything, this exercise has taught us that we can be better at how we also identify or articulate what we truly want as a goal. And the reason is that if you look at a lot of the statements that are in the goals, they're pretty broad.
Right.
So when you sit there and say that one of your goals is diversify the tax base, that's a pretty broad assessment to then sit there at the end of the year and say, did we really achieve that or did we not? There's really no current understandable metrics that's assigned to that. So I hope that in the next cycle, that the lesson that we've learned is that we can tear that down and truly have what we want, and then what is the metrics that we all agree to that will tell us whether we achieve that. Because I can tell you right now, I have no idea whether or not we diversified the tax base. Yes, we worked with CITCO, and we did a great job. But I had no idea whether, I mean, when I came on, I can tell you that I think that during the whole debate process, or at least the forum process as a candidate, I was told that the, 25 or 30% of our tax base right now is business-related. The remaining is residential. I don't know, did we move one percentage point? Did we move two? Did we move 10? And to me, that's more substantive than having a conversation around it. Yeah, well, we improved our relationships with CITCO, and that's not a measure of diversifying tax base.
Right, those are that's an example of measurable statistics, whether we want to increase employment by 2%.
Right. We can
validate that.
Right.
And again, that's part of what I'm hoping we can do with the folks that we are.
Well, that leads us right into back to budget, which Tom has some great, great things he'd like to talk about.
Yeah.
Really?
You did.
You did.
You really.
Great things.
Great things.
Well, I mean, I provided an update in terms of more forward-looking than looking back. With all due respect, I think this is a conversation the council ought to have in terms of looking backward, what went well, what went wrong. Not wrong, but not so wrong. I I guess my assessment on that is that I thought the process internally between certainly the town's finance committee and the Board of Education, frankly, that relationship was better than I've never ever seen it since I've been in Scarborough. So I think we really made some great advancements, and I'd hope, like to capitalize on those going forward.
Mm-hmm.
Where we fell down is when we went to the voters. And
it was a communication piece, yeah.
It's a communication piece. I think how the budgets are formulated and presented in day one, you know, is part of that answer, if you will. Making things easier for people to understand is another one. So that's the piece that I think we need to really have laser focus on going forward is connecting with the voters, because they're an essential part of that process, whether we like it or not. It's a requirement.
You know, one of the things that we might want to think about doing is going out to the public and asking the public, what types of goals would you like to see the town address?
It's a great idea.
Rather than just us.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure there's a lot of underlying things going on. I mean, the seniors have always been talking about a senior center. So maybe that's a goal. Not a senior center, but how do we provide more resources and so on and so forth to the seniors. But I'm sure there's a lot of things out there that people would like to see done that we really don't have any idea that's in their head, unless we go out there and ask.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, I like that. It's kind of a two-edged sword. We should kind of ask at the beginning of the season, what are the items? And then ask at the conclusion, how do we do? So there's also a feedback loop about whatever goals we establish, you know, do we communicate, whatever it may be, that we actually have that feedback loop at the end. That was a great idea.
I think understanding what residents want is essential. My only fear with that is that starting with some of you as individuals with
mm-hmm.
different ideas, we come up with this list that we already agreed is a bit unwieldy. Now we might have choices many. And so my only concern is that
how do you
pare that down a bit?
It's almost a question of how do you do effective polling? How do you get a good insight from your constituency? I think just whether it was a questionnaire or allowing people to just post on a Facebook page, I'm not sure that is ever going to really result in meaningful information from which we would make decisions. I sort of see the committees. We really have a tentacle out into the community on what's going on. We have long-range planning. We have transportation. We have a planning department.
Mm-hmm.
We've got a lot of elements that are in place that are supposed to, including ourselves, say, where are we coming up short? Where does the community really want senior advisory? When you think of all the big components, we've got them, and I liked this workshop idea. I thought they were all productive, and I could see workshops with the committees, because they really never get any time with us.
Sure.
Here's your chance to tell us where you think we should be going based on the input you're getting.
No, I was just going to suggest that, I can understand the desire to constantly want to pull the constituents that we serve and say, what is it that you want us to do? But the fact is that in this form of government, they elect us to reasonably assess, based upon our similarities, what we think is the best for the community, and then they tell us what is right or wrong. I'm not saying not to pull them. I just don't think that is the... once you start that, then when do you stop? When do you use it in one situation? When do you not use it? And I look, like Bill said, I think that, you have senior advisory committee, you have energy committee, you have not solid waste, you have the clam diggers, shellfish committee. You have all these committees. I mean, there's 13, 15, 17 committees.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so maybe the goal is that we build better working relationships with those committees and take their recommendations for some of the things that we set as goals. Because I think it's a humongous challenge trying to identify that, because nothing guarantees, even when you sit there, and by the way, if you're going to send out a poll to every citizen in Scarborough and ask them, what is it that you want us to do? You're never going to pick the right thing, because you're going to still have a certain level of constituency that's going to say, I didn't want you to do that first. I wanted to do this other thing first.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, and it's about the fortitude that we have and what we want to then prioritize for the community and what we set for. So it's a humongous challenge.
I think an open-ended survey would be unwieldy.
Right.
But I think you could construct a survey that would poll people in terms of their preference on a couple of fairly narrow topics, if you want, and help you prioritize.
But you're going to want it done by someone's professional poller,
because otherwise
you're dealing...
It has to be unbiased.
It has to be unbiased. It has to be, you know...
Yeah. But if you think about the item that we had on our list here that we didn't really, survey of services that tied into aging in place, I mean, really, it's not just about aging in place, it's about all the services that we're providing. What is the quality of that, and then what do we need to identify to then service those aging in place? And that's the great way to start that whole dialogue around everything that we provide, which then becomes, what's our priority? What's their ranking? You know, do they want us to provide greater law enforcement to protect our homes? Do they want us to provide greater education? I mean, whatever it might be. And there's ways, you know, professional statisticians and survey takers, you know, that's what they do, so.
Yeah, I think that's what that item was in there. I mean, the other thing, though, we can take a page out of what the school department does. The school department actually runs their groups. And I participate, you know, the middle school around George. But it's a way to kind of ask the parents of students in the community things that they think are important for education.
Right.
And it was a well-run thing, and they use that then to inform sort of their process going forward.
Okay.
People like to participate. Their voice is heard. So, there may be models that we could use to get us to a different place.
You refer to the community dialogue?
Yeah.
I mean, it's an interesting way to get input.
Yeah.
And the agenda, in terms of being unbiased, the agenda is set by those that show up.
But what you're missing are the people who don't show up. And they have opinions also.
And those are the ones that come after the fact and say, you never told me that you had these meetings. You never told me in that.
But that's
a challenge
just
that we have.
Add one small kind of parting thought on that is something that was I found as a really useful exercise when I was first elected early on is I kind of made my tour around through all the departments,
right.
and I asked a very simple, basic question of each department head, which is, what do you foresee as being, you know, your number one item? What's the thing you need the most, or what's the thing that you're lacking and really could use? And it was a very interesting and good exercise to go through. And ironically, both the police chief and the fire chief were about like that in their answer,
oh,
a building. That wasn't even a split second thought. But I think that's a good exercise, too, that maybe could get incorporated is before you start your budget process next year, it would be worth the effort to try to gauge a little what do your individual departments see as, you know, a really pressing need. You know, if that's public works and they say, boy, you know, we blew the engine in the street sweeper and we know we have to sweep, so that's our number one budget priority. I think that would be a worthwhile exercise just to kind of, unfortunately, Tom is a little too good at his job and, you know, redlines quite a bit long before it even hits finance committee and then it hits council from there. And it's not to say that some of those things aren't, you know, necessary. It's just we don't even get the opportunity to hear it. So it would
Tom, would
be
that
worth
be,
it.
You know, we've got April 1st date for the issuance of a budget by the town manager.
Mm-hmm.
Where would that fit in to the timeline if we were all trying to have a 20 minutes with each department? department head, to just understand where they're at, knowing that the budget process will then go blitzing forward during April and May. It's a, you know, a 60-day dash. I don't know. It just sounds like it'd be awfully educational.
Well, if you're talking budget priorities, I think the system we have in place has me propose a budget, which includes synthesizing all of the input from my staff and coming up with a budget that hopefully meets your larger goals. So I might suggest that you're getting a little in the weeds, frankly, and that's what you pay me for. But in those conversations, there might be things that aren't really budget goals. They're much loftier goals.
Longer
term. The need for building or what have you. So there can be, you know, great takeaways out of those asking that simple question. You know, one strategy I've used in the past that has had some success, I ask my department's heads to establish their own goals, and I can simply share those with you so you can read them and just get a sense of what they're thinking. That's kind of just another input tool that we could plug into this.
Because your new format has all the big items that they're saying this is why this is the way it is.
Great, right.
It's a great process.
Yes. Yeah, that format looks a little backward. It says, what did we accomplish last year?
Yeah.
More importantly, what do we look to do in this budget year, and what are our drivers? What's really making the difference?
Right.
And that's intended to be a simple read for you.
Is them having the opportunity to tell us what the drivers are in their budget.
I mean, that sounds so simple. I can't believe I'm 23 years in this business, and I guess I knew it, but I didn't ever appreciate how important it was. It's not numbers. It's about telling stories, about people being able to understand we're here and we need to get there.
That's right.
And how do we do it?
And we now have 18 plow runs instead of 12, so you need an extra guy in a truck. It's that simple.
And when you push it out to the public, to someone who's totally uninitiated and knows nothing about what public works Scarborough is, if they can spend 5 minutes and get a sense of, okay, there's a vehicle maintenance division, an operations division, they have 18 plow runs, and get some context, so then the numbers start to make a little more sense, rather than, oh, the budget's going up X over last year and we don't know why. So I fully appreciate how important it is to tell the story.
You know, one of the auxiliary things that I do is I get to serve on the Cumberland County Budget Committee. And all I got to tell you is that if you think this went wrong, wait till you sit on the County Budget Committee process. It was a huge challenge. But the great thing that happened was that I was able to present actually Scarborough's format for its budget, and which is now going to become, there's some modification, it's going to become the new format that is now shared with actually 28 other communities, because it was appreciated about how Scarborough used that format to tell a story of its services and then what did it want in addition to that going forward. And it becomes, you know, that storybook about why do we need, in the county situation, a 2.94% increase in its budget. And it was widely accepted even by the smaller communities like Casco and Bridgeton and, you know, all the others. So, you know, I think if anything out of the budget process, out of what we've achieved locally in our process with the school board, is that our representation at the regional level speaks volumes, because I've always thought and always appreciated Scarborough being a regional leader in everything that we do. And so to be that, and I really want to commend, you know, Tom and Ruth and all of their managers and how they present it, because I presented our budget to them and they were like, wow, this does tell a story. It's better than those line item things that everyone certainly, every other town does the same thing, by the way.
I know.
They look at line items and they actually argue about why did it go from $500 to $2,000 in 1 year?
Yeah.
On a $73 million budget, to be honest, really? You're really concerned about why? I mean, that isn't the concern.
But if all we give you is numbers, it's not surprising.
That's
what you're focused on.
You know, Tom, I think you raised a good point that I think, and it's, you know, I love the quote by Wayne Gretzky, asking why he's a great hockey player. He goes, I skate to where the puck's going to be, or everybody else is where the puck is. But I think that element you talked about, the communication piece with our constituents, it's been really hard to figure out where is it we want to be? Where is it do we want to be as a town, whether it's a public safety building or other things? And so one of the enhancements we think about doing is how do we tell that story better about where are we going? So the, here are the numbers this year, but more importantly, what does that mean into the future, and what does that mean? I think that, that just helps fill out that story.
Yeah.
And I don't think we've done a good job of really
looking ahead. On the budget, the one thing, well, there's a couple of things I think all people, regardless of their persuasion and how they felt about the budget, agreed on. They want predictability.
Right.
Whether that's where's our tax rate going, or predictability in how are we going to continue to fund schools at appropriate levels. That's a huge part. And so we've started. You're talking about really being able to forecast further out than just one budget year.
Or at least trying to, where are we trying to go? And when are we going to get there? And what does that need for investment? And
are those reasonable goals and targets should we be striving for?
Yeah, and you want to present a value proposition. We call it my business value proposition. What is it that I'm getting for my money?
The secondary challenge to that is that there's no example out there that does that for us to look at and say, at least here's a baseline. If anybody can name me one community that projects and forecasts where they want to be in 5 years, I'd love to know what the
name
of that
community
is.
I know.
They can't, the challenge is so difficult because of the composition of the budget, the revenue stream in which that comes in, and then how everything else is then managed. So I'm all for it. Want to move there? Please show me any community that's gotten there. Yep, because to me, that's a baseline. You can change what worked for them and make it work for us. You can add to it, subtract from it, reshape it, do whatever you can. I have never found it.
Well, especially with so many external factors, too, that impact on us. You got state, you got federal, you've got what's going on in the political winds, you've got what's going on in the economy, you've got what's the value, you know, you've got all these factors.
And
you
have a council that changes to leave.
Yeah,
no,
you
just
So, are there any other questions or discussion around kind of our goal recap or?
Are we going to report anything out to so folks can see? Is this the document that's going to become available?
Tom, we can load that online, correct? Okay?
It's on the website.
Yeah.
It's available for folks. We can give it a little higher. I'll give it a higher profile because we won't have to dig for it. We'll give it a headline, if you will.
Sure. Cool. Thank you.
Very good.
All right. So we'll.
I like the idea of metrics that allow you to judge whether you're meeting, and the budget's a big deal. And we have, stability in tax rate. And we've always had that. I think that's repeated itself year in and year out. Low, as low as we can possibly get, predictable, affordable tax increases. And so I'd love to, not tonight, because I think we're looking back, but in the future, I'd love to talk about metrics that maybe would address that. I saw Mike Turek, and he had said something about a 3% tax increase, and not in stone, but, you know, if you're just trying to set goals, where do you want to end up? Well, you want to have, what do we all think is predictable or reasonable year in and year out? Because I think that townspeople, taxpayers have a right to expect that of us, that we're not going to be up and down, up and down. And it's impossible sometimes not to be. We get stuck in a very difficult situation with Augusta and funding us this year. And so that's an exceptional circumstance that we were lucky to have work out in our favor to get us to a reasonable rate. But I do think that would be, it would be something I'd like to at least talk about amongst the council.
When we did that in years past, too, you know, we set a tangible mark that we were shooting for, you know, that recognizing that, times were tight for quite a while, and we just point blank said, you know, well, X is kind of this, and we're expecting this in pay scale, so we don't want to exceed this in the tax, you know, tax increase by percentage. It's not unheard of.
Yeah, 2009 was the only year I could think of where the council was crystal clear in their expectation and they met it, and that was a 0% tax increase, because that was, at that point, we were all acutely aware that we were in
out of recession.
Yeah, and didn't want to be part of the problem, we wanted to be part of the solution.
I think Councilor Holbrook and I were the only two on there at the time.
That's right, you were.
But it's dependability. I think that's what people want.
Mm-hmm.
Stability.
So a reasonable expectation of what's coming year in and year out.
The last case, I just wanted to acknowledge Councilor Blaze's challenge to us regarding labor contracts.
Mm-hmm.
When you look at school having 73% of the budget being fixed by salary and benefits in the town lesser, but still significant, to make appreciable difference, to be predictable and stable, requires structural change, and that doesn't happen overnight. It happens through contracts and successive contracts. It could take a decade to steer that ship in another direction. So his point's extremely well taken. I just want to mention that it doesn't happen overnight.
All things government work slow.
I didn't mention it to you, Ed, but after you sent that email, I sent an email to Tom saying we need a serious education ourselves on all of the contracts. What's the history been?
Right.
What has been the philosophy that drove those, and what's our strategy for moving forward? And I think you kind of raised a consciousness that I think we should be carrying on beyond your term.
Yeah, and with that, we're going to put together a spreadsheet or a matrix that will show, I don't know, 10 or 12, 15 basic elements seen in each of the contracts, so we can start to see where the similarities are, where things are a little divergent, and maybe start to bring things more into focus.
Share it with the school.
The opportunities. Right, it has to be done collaboratively.
Yeah, because they're separate.
You know, Tom, one of the things that the Finance Committee never really was able to finish, primarily because of time and schedule, was that we were supposed to conduct this lessons learned conversation around the budgetary process and what did we encounter, both positive that was new, as well as what could we change. And, you know, one of the things that was proposed as part of that was this data analysis that could go into how do we look at the school's budget from the objective view that we're supposed to take and not necessarily be subjective because we don't have that authority to do that. And so I hope, if anything, one of the new objectives for next year is that we fully undertake that process and not simply rhetorically state that we're going to do it, but really undertake it, because we did not complete that process this year, primarily because of time, and it was challenging. So I appreciate the analysis, but at the same time, I also am in reserved in what it states.
All right. Well, with that, we'll go ahead and wrap up our workshop, and we'll be reconvening at 7 p.m. for our regular